Welcome to this episode of Intellectual Catholicism. Today, I'm here with Dr. Michael Barber of the Augustine Institute. Before we start, I just want to have Dr. Barber introduce himself and also talk about, I guess, since our topic is popular misconceptions on the Bible, why are there so many popular misconceptions about the Bible? So first, introduce yourself and tell us why there are so many misconceptions.
Sure. Well, my name is Michael Barber. I'm a biblical scholar at the Augustine Institute and theologian here. Written a number of books. My most recent book is The Historical Jesus and the Temple, Memory, Methodology, and the Gospel of Matthew. I have a picture of it right here, or a copy of it right here, forwarded by Dale Allison. Mm-hmm. And I've written a number of other things. We could talk about those. I might mention them here or there as we go along. Let's see, why are there so many misconceptions about the Bible? Well, there are a lot of things that get said in popular literature over the pulpit. We might call it pulpit fiction. Right? there are a lot of pulpit fictions out there. Some of the origins of that are actually pretty dark and scary. There has long been in biblical studies a sort of deep respect for German biblical scholarship. That's typically seen to be the place where critical scholarship really emerges. And so some of the leading figures, the people who most shape contemporary biblical studies, people in the past like Julius Wellhausen and others, they often wrote in a context, you know, 19th century Germany, early 20th century Germany, where there are, frankly, a lot of anti-Semitic tendencies. And so there are a lot of things that are said that people don't realize we've inherited from a place and a time where Judaism was going to be portrayed in the most negative light that it could be. And, you know, I think what people often want to do is they want to emphasize how great Jesus is. And they feel like in order to do that, they have to set up his Jewish backdrop as a kind of negative foil. And so that tends to amplify critiques of Jesus's Jewish culture. And so that creates problems. There are just a lot of things too that are said by people who don't know any better. People who don't really have research skills, people who aren't real scholars, who don't go to academic conferences. You know, it's one thing to write books. That doesn't make you a scholar. It's another thing to get a degree. You could even get a PhD. But the fact of the matter is the field of biblical studies is constantly changing. Not because, you know, we have wildly different interpretations of basic biblical texts. Well, Paul doesn't think love is important anymore. No, it's not like that, right? But the fact of the matter is we're constantly learning new things about the ancient world, and we're becoming sharper in the distinctions that we make. Make no mistake about it, there are biblical scholars who do work that is unhelpful. I'm not trying to say all contemporary biblical scholarship is great and wonderful. But going to conferences, presenting at academic conferences, presenting papers is an important way scholars keep up with the field. And you can very quickly see where people are depending on older materials and repeating things that maybe they've heard, but that aren't true. So there's a lot of stuff like that. So we can get into that and give some examples of it as we move forward. But hopefully that answers that question.
Sure. So we have today 14 claims that we're going to tackle.
Okay,
and
great.
Then we'll do a part two where we hit 15 claims. So
okay.
So almost to 30. There were so many others that we could have chosen for this.
Yes.
You sent me a list originally of 41 claims. Maybe we'll tackle some of those later. But for the 14 today, I want to.
Well, you asked me for 10, I think. And I said, I don't know. And I was just sitting at my desk. And I was like, well, I don't know. What are some, I think you said, what are 10 common misconceptions about the Bible?
Right.
And so I was like, oh man, we could do this all day. So I just started like pounding them out. And then I was like, well, which ones do you want to talk about? You tell me. Yeah. So that's how we ended up with the list that we have. And I was just doing it stream of consciousness while I was working on some other things. We could have easily come up with 100, right? Mm. thought about it long enough. As I was just thinking about this today and looking at the list, I was looking at it last night and put some, you know, slides together with some Bible verses. I was thinking, oh, there's another one we could talk about. Oh, there's another one we could talk about. You know, you multiply this quite a bit. There's a lot there.
Right. And I'm sure, like, in your career as a professor, you've heard and had to, you know, deal with multiple misconceptions. And so I know that you have like a PDF that you want to share.
Yes, I do.
And so yeah. I'll let you do that.
Great.
And
We can just talk about, you know, as we go through these. So sure. Why don't we talk about the first one? I think this was the one you were really intrigued with when I brought it up to you at one point.
Yeah. Do you want me to just say what the claims
are?
Yeah,
why don't you talk about it? Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So the first claim that is going to be debunked is that the high priest had a cord and bell wrapped around him when he went behind the temple veil, so that if he died while he was in the presence of God, they could drag him out.
Okay. So yeah, that's right. This gets repeated quite a bit. You'll see this even in some study Bibles. And I can't tell you how many times I've had students. I teach at the Augustine Institute Graduate School. A little plug. We have a great program in theology here. We have about 500 students studying on campus and online. We also have a master's in biblical studies program that's really for those who want to go on and do further academic work. But anyway, I get lots of students who come in and they already know a bit about the Bible. And so they'll say stuff like this, like, oh, the high priest, you know, he had a rope around his ankle and if he died, they'd pull his body out. What's your source for that? You know, where do you get that information? Oh, well, and nobody can tell you, right? So first of all, did the high priest wear rope and did he wear bells? Well, yeah, I mean, he did wear bells. And we can see that, for example, in the book of Exodus, we have a description of what the high priest was supposed to wear. You shall make the robe of the ephod of all blue, and it shall have an opening for the head in the middle of it, with a woven binding around its edge, like the opening in a garment, so that it may not be torn. On its lower hem, you shall make pomegranates of purple, blue, purple, and crimson, yarns all around the lower hem with bells of gold between them all around. A golden bell and a pomegranate alternating all around the lower hem of the robe. Aaron shall wear it when he ministers, and its sound shall be heard when he goes into the holy place before the Lord, and when he comes out, so that he may not die. Okay, so let's just talk about this for a second. What is this talking about? When he goes into the holy place, it's not the Holy of Holies, right? The holy place is the place right before the Holy of Holies. When he goes into this place, we have the bread of the presence. We have other things there in the middle of the sanctuary. But that's not talking about what happens on Yom Kippur. And actually, if you look at the book of Leviticus, we have a description of what the high priest is supposed to wear when he goes into the Holy of Holies on that great feast day of Yom Kippur. We read, he shall put on the linen tunic and shall have the linen undergarments next to his body, fasten the linen sash, and wear the linen turban. These are the holy vestments. He shall bathe his body in water and he shall put them on. Notice it doesn't say anything about a rope around his ankle. And it doesn't even talk about the blue ephod here or the bells, which is interesting. And there is a bit of debate, because if you look at the Mishnah, and I know you know what the Mishnah is, Swan, but just for listeners, the Mishnah is a second century collection of rabbinic traditions and rabbinic sayings. There's a brand new edition of it that just came out in 3 volumes from Oxford University Press. I think you ordered a copy of this recently, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, literally right before we started, when you told me that there was a massive discount on the paperback edition.
There is.
Oh, yeah. I jumped.
Short time only. Yeah. But when we read the Mishnah account of what the high priest does on Yom Kippur, they're wrestling too with the text of Leviticus. What is it exactly that the high priest is supposed to wear when he goes into the Holy of Holies? So when you read the Leviticus commentary by Jacob Milgram, for example, he explains it doesn't really seem that the high priest is wearing all of his vestments when he goes in. So whether he has bells on, that's not really clear. Remember, Holy of Holies is behind the veil, right? Beyond the holy place. So in the holy place, you have two parts. You have the front part where you have the bread of the presence, where you have the menorah, okay? And then you have a veil. You go beyond that veil and you enter into the Holy of Holies. The high priest can only go in there once a year, all right? There's no text from the time of Jesus. There's no text in the Mishnah. There's no text in the Babylonian Talmud, which is in the 5th century. That's hundreds of years after the time of Jesus. There's no text that says that the high priest, when he went into the Holy of Holies, had a rope around his ankle so that they could drag his body out if he died. Now, there are clear indications that they were concerned that the high priest might die in the Holy of Holies. It was a fearful thing. He had to confess his sins. They took this very seriously, right? But there isn't any specific text that goes back to the first century that is historically reliable that says that he wore a rope or something around his ankle. Where is that found? Well, you have to get all the way to like the 1200s. You have to get to Kabbalah Judaism. That's where you first find this tradition. It's in what's known as the Zohar, okay? And in the Zohar, we read that a rabbi, ancient rabbi, talked about a chain being tied, I'll just quote it, to the feet of the high priest when he entered the Holy of Holies, so that if he dies, there they will take him out, since it is forbidden to enter there. So this is the 13th century, it's the 1200s. That's the first time we have any reference to this, right? So why is it that so many people have thought that this happened in Jesus's day? Well, if you look at older books, they wouldn't be very selective in their use of Jewish sources, right? So if a rabbi said something, they would say, oh, well, this is what they did in Jesus's day. But we have to be more discriminating than that. We have to be a little bit more careful because we do recognize that the authors, even of the Mishnah, aren't always reliable in what they're telling us about 100 years earlier, right? Let alone the Babylonian Talmud or the Zohar, which is much, much, much later. So here we have a misconception, right? That people in Jesus's day did this. They did not. And I think it's instructive because it helps us to think critically about what sources we're using to reconstruct Jesus's culture, the Judaism of Jesus's day, if we can use that expression. Does that help?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's something that I've had to learn in my own kind of online career. You know, at first, you would hear other people just haphazardly cite the Talmud and the Mishnah and just say, this is how it was during Jesus's day. And then you learned about, okay, wait, actually some of these stories contradict each other. Or you have one rabbi give this account and then the later rabbi gives another account. And then you can, or you can tell that the stories are clearly fictitious or propaganda.
Yes.
So then you have to be careful. It doesn't mean that you can't trace anything back to the first century.
That's right. That's
right. You
have
to be careful.
Yeah. I mean, one of the amazing things that people don't talk about enough, in my opinion, is that the first instance of the word rabbi, which, of course, we find throughout the rabbinic writings, like the Mishnah, the Talmud, right? But the first time we have that language of rabbi are in the New Testament books.
Wow.
Right? So it's the New Testament that actually first uses a term that is later used in later Jewish sources. But we wouldn't want to say, oh, well, these later Jewish sources are unreliable, totally unreliable because they're so much later. No, we actually do have evidence. And there are lots of other things that we could talk about, but there are lots of ways that the Mishnah in particular and other rabbinic writings can help shed light on things we see in the New Testament. But we also have to be very careful about the use of those sources. And this is why, you know, a lot of people will use these kinds of things, popularizers, people who give lectures, priests, deacons, and people who know better sit in the pew and they think, oh, these guys don't know what they're talking about. And so it goes to our credibility. We have to be careful about the way we appropriate these sources.
All right, claim number two.
All right.
Matthew has Jesus speak of the kingdom of heaven as a reverential circumlocution because he did not want to use kingdom of God. I've heard this one a lot.
Yes. Now, there is a key book, a critical book that I'd want to highlight here. It first was published by Brill, and then it was republished by Baker Academic. And the book is called Heaven and Earth in the Gospel of Matthew, written by a friend of mine, Jonathan Pennington. Now, I didn't know Jonathan when I first read his book, but I can't read the gospel without now thinking about Jonathan Pennington. It's so weird, but every time I read the Gospel of Matthew and I run into that expression, the kingdom of heaven, then I think, oh, wow, I hope Jonathan's doing well, right? Because it's totally changed my understanding. Now, what Pennington goes back to show is that this idea that Matthew uses the kingdom of heaven instead of kingdom of God, because he doesn't want to say God, goes back to Gustav Dahlmann, an early biblical scholar in the early 1900s. And this is just asserted without real evidence for this. And the biggest problem with this theory is that, and it's been repeated many times. Well, Matthew's a Jewish writer. He doesn't want to say kingdom of heaven. So he doesn't want to say kingdom of God, but he does say kingdom of God. He says kingdom of God in Matthew 12, 28, 19, 24. 21:31, 43. So yeah, Jesus actually uses the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven in Matthew. So if Matthew is thinking, oh wow, I'm really nervous, I don't want to use God, but somehow, you know, his piety lapsed when he got to chapter 12 or something like that. Now, what Pennington shows is that the use of heaven here is deliberate. And throughout the gospel, he shows the way heaven and earth are set up in a kind of contrast, where what happens in heaven is there we see the realm in which God's rule in Christ is fully realized, right? In the heavenly realm, all things are made subject to God's rule in Christ. And what we're praying for is that that reality in heaven, that realm, would be made present on earth. And so mostly the Lord's Prayer, right? Our Father, I think I just dropped out. What happened there? Our Father who art in heaven. Hang on, let's see if I can get back here. So this contrast between heaven and earth is especially seen in the Lord's Prayer, right? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, right? And then if you look at the Gospel of Matthew, you get to this climactic idea then in the climax of the gospel. So the final verses of the gospel are emphasizing this. What do we read there? We read in the final verses, right? We see all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age. So here at the end of the gospel, what happens? Heaven and earth, all authority in heaven and earth, are now united in the person of Christ, right? And so what we see is in the person of Christ, all things that have been kind of in tension with God are now being resolved, right? And what I especially like, I have to just mention this from the standpoint of Catholic tradition, is notice that coming together of heaven and earth is linked to the church's sacramental ministry. Go baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So it's in, we might say, in the sacraments of the church that we especially see this coming together of heaven and earth, which is really what sacramental theology wants to develop further, right? That in the Mass, in the Eucharist, what happens? Well, we're saying the prayers of the angels every Sunday, right? When we come together and celebrate the liturgy, the glory to God in the highest. Why? That's the prayer of the angels. And we sing that because heaven is touching down to earth. So Matthew's being very deliberate about that expression, kingdom of heaven. It's not just a way of getting around saying kingdom of God. There's a lot more going on there.
And is there, I think Pennington mentions this, if I'm not mistaken, is there a slight nuance between the meaning of when he uses heaven in the plural versus the singular?
Yes, he does get into that, but it depends on whether earth is being used also in that expression. So yeah, but he does show, Pennington shows that this is very consistent throughout the Gospel of Matthew, which is really interesting.
That's wonderful. All right. Claim number
three. Okay, let me just say one thing. We'll go on. Well, I can say one more thing about everything we do. We'll never
forget. Yeah. All right. Claim number three. This is a big one. The Pharisees were rigid / legalistic.
Aha. Yeah. Now, this is a scary one, right? This is another one of those misconceptions that reinforce anti-Semitic stereotypes. All right. And, you know, just recently, and I say recently in the last few years, this has been front page news, this idea of the use of Pharisaical, right, as a pejorative. Pope Francis, at the beginning of his pontificate, would use Pharisaical, you know, this is a Pharisaical approach, don't be a Pharisee, to mean something like, don't be a hypocrite, or don't be rigid, or something like that. And a number of Jewish scholars flew to Rome and met with the Holy Father. And they sat down with him and they said, Holy Father, you have to knock this off. Right? This is very offensive to Jewish ears, because in Jewish tradition, Pharisees are the heroes. Pharisees are they're associated with the earliest and most important rabbis. And so when you are using Pharisaical as a pejorative, you're doing something that is reinforcing anti-Semitic stereotypes. And, you know, if you go back to the Gospels and you look at the Gospels, you see Jesus actually doesn't condemn the Pharisees for being rigid, right? In fact, there's evidence in the Gospels that they're not. Let me give you just a for instance, right? We could talk about this for a whole episode, but let's look at one episode, Matthew chapter 12. Jesus is being criticized for healing on the Sabbath. And Jesus said to them, which one of you who has a sheep that falls into a pit on the Sabbath will not take hold of it and lift it out? Who would let an animal die on the Sabbath? How could you be so heartless? Well, who would do such a thing? The Essenes. We know this from the Dead Sea Scrolls. We know in the Dead Sea Scrolls that you were not permitted to rescue your animal on the Sabbath. This is from a document in the scrolls known as the Damascus Document. It says, no one, I'm using the translation here by Martinez and Tig Shalar, which I think is the best translation. No one should help an animal give birth on the Sabbath day. And if it falls into a well or a pit, he should not take it out on the Sabbath. So we know that in Jesus' day, there were different kinds of Jews, right? So people will do this all the time. Well, in Jesus' day, Jews believed. Well, which Jews are you talking about? That's like saying in 21st century America, Christians today believe. Well, which Christians are you talking about? You know, Catholics, Protestants have very different ideas. And then, of course, there are different Catholics who have different understandings of what it means to be Catholic. There are different Protestants who have different understandings of what it means to be a Protestant, right? To say Jews in the first century is a bit misleading, right? So we know that there are Pharisees. They believed in the Torah, but they also believed in other writings like the prophets. They believed in life after death. They believed in resurrection of the dead. Then there were the Sadducees, and the Sadducees didn't believe these things. That's why they're sad, you see. They didn't believe in life. Sorry, that was that joke. You've heard that one before, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. Sorry, we all have to do this. But you'll do it yourself, promise, if you haven't already. But the Pharisees were known, apparently, for not their rigidness, but the Essenes seemed to criticize them for being too lax, actually, in their interpretation of the law. The evidence for this is seen in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So there is a fragment in the Dead Sea Scrolls where it refers to the seekers of smooth things. It's a pejorative reference to those who want to smooth out the law. They want to find loopholes, is the way that this is understood usually. And although it's not 100% sure that it's the Pharisees, scholars have generally thought that this is a reference to the Pharisees. It might not be, but I think a lot of times people come to this passage, they try to figure out who this could be. Some people say it's Ephraimite, some people say everything, but I think it is a reference to the Pharisees myself. But and we have later rabbinic, you know, traditions about the kinds of debates that were going on in the first century. And oftentimes the rabbis of the first century are associated with the Pharisees. So, for example, we might look at a debate that people might know about. It's the debate about divorce and remarriage. The school of Shammai say, this is now from the Mishnah, the school of Shammai say, a man may not divorce his wife unless he has found unchastity in her, for it is written, it quotes Deuteronomy 24, because he has found in her indecency in anything. So you can't divorce your wife, according to the school of Shammai, unless she's committed adultery. And that's because Deuteronomy 24 says you can divorce her if you found indecency. Indecency must be referenced to adultery. But the school of Hillel says he may divorce her even if she spoiled a dish for him. So if your wife makes a bad meal, you can divorce her, right? Why? Because he has found in her indecency in anything. So they put the emphasis at the end of the word. There's indecency in anything. So it's not just adultery, but if the food is indecent, you can divorce her, right? And then Rabbi Akiba says, even if he should find another fairer than she, for it is written, and it shall be if she find no favor in his eyes. Deuteronomy 24:1. Now, there's a lot we could say about that passage and the way it's using the different rabbis to help us think more carefully about what Deuteronomy 24 is saying, and whether we should take this as a historical account about what these specific Pharisees held. I think there's some debate about that. But you can see how people who are not Pharisees might look at arguments like that and say, oh, you're looking for loopholes, right? So the idea that the Pharisees were the rigid ones, the ones that were extremely legalistic and strict, actually, the Essenes were much stricter than that. And they looked at the Pharisees and thought that they were actually too lax, it seems. And one other passage I just want to highlight is in the Gospel of Matthew. I think this is the most overlooked passage in the New Testament. That's what I think. Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, the scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. So do and observe some of the things they tell you. That's not what he says. Do and observe whatever they tell you. Wow. I mean, that, to imagine Jesus is in a scene is unthinkable. How can he say the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat? The Greek word there is cathedra. That's where we get the word cathedral. The cathedral is the church where the bishop has his seat. Right? So here in Matthew 23, you have to do and observe whatever the Pharisees tell you to do. So Jesus is not condemning the Pharisees because they're too rigid. He goes on to say, for they preach, but they do not practice. Notice here, the problem for Jesus is not what they preach. It's that they don't live up to their own preaching. So you can't make the claim that Jesus is going after the Pharisees because they're too rigid. That is not right, right? So I think that's a misconception that's out there that needs to be rethought. And one other passage that just never gets mentioned is found in the Gospel of Luke. We read in the Gospel of Luke, at that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to him, go away from here, for Herod wants to kill you. Here the Pharisees are actually helping Jesus in this scene. And we know later on, right, in the New Testament, who was it that, which Jews were most likely to become members of the church? Which Jews? It was the Pharisees. Notice in the book of Acts, Paul's on trial. And when he's on trial, he is looking at the Sanhedrin. He sees that some were Sadducees, others were Pharisees. He called out in the council, "Brothers, I am a Pharisee." He doesn't say, "I was a Pharisee." It's not past tense. Acts doesn't indicate that Paul was a former Pharisee after the Damascus Road experience. According to Acts, Paul continues to be a Pharisee. Got to think about that. Now, he's a Pharisee who is in the Messiah, he's a Pharisee who believes that the new covenant has done, right? But he still sees himself as a Pharisee. So I think it's important to think through some of these texts and recognize, you know, when we speak about the Pharisees in pejorative, negative terms, we're not really being fair to the full witness of the New Testament. Joseph of Arimathea is a Pharisee, right? Nicodemus is a Pharisee, comes to Jesus. So we know that there, and the book of Acts talks about other Pharisees who joined the church. So I think we need to be really cautious about this and watch ourselves, because we're actually putting up barriers to our Jewish friends and to communion and friendship with our Jewish friends, right? Because when they hear us going on and on about these kinds of things, it's like Catholics, you know, who hear non-Catholics talk about the Dark Ages. Oh, yeah. You mean that time before the Protestant Reformation brought luminous light to the world, right? So we got to be a little bit more careful about that.
Yeah, and I know for a lot of people, it's so easy when you just read Matthew 23 in isolation to kind of maybe you gloss over the first three verses and then you get into all the woes, you know, the woe sayings of Jesus.
Oh, sure, right. Yes.
And then you think, well, that's just the whole story, right? And then, I mean, another passage I love is Matthew chapter 5. I think it's verses 20 to 22 when Jesus talks about, if you call your brother a fool, you'll be liable to the Sanhedrin. And then He also talks about, if your righteousness has to surpass those of the scribes and Pharisees. It doesn't work if he didn't think that they were actually righteous.
Right. That's a great point. Absolutely. 100%. And we can look at other passages in Paul, like in Philippians, where he talks about, as to the law, he was a Pharisee before Christ. But does that mean that he's no longer a Pharisee? Not according to Acts, right? There's a lot of things that we can say there. It seems to me, this is just my experience, that you argue the most with the people you're closest to.
Yeah.
Mm. And so it seems to me that Catholics are a lot less tolerant of other Catholics who disagree with them on what it means to be a Catholic than they are with Jews or Muslims or atheists. All right. And I think that's just part of the way. I think there's a social dynamic there that is true, just not of our own time only, but even in the first century. Why is it that Jesus is often at odds with the Pharisees? I think it's because they're the ones that he's closest to.
Right.
They're the ones he expects the most of. And so, to whom much is given, much is expected, right? So I think that's especially why there's such sharp disagreement between Jesus and the Pharisees, precisely because they are so close.
So much we can say here, but we have to move on.
Right, move on.
All right, claim number four. When Jesus was speaking of the rock of the church, he was talking about a pagan temple at Caesarea Philippi.
Yes. So have you been to the Holy Land?
Not yet.
Okay, you'll get there. You'll get there. I was supposed to go this year, 3 days before the Hamas attacks. In fact, I was playing a game of chicken with the airline, waiting to see if I would cancel my ticket first or if they were going to cancel the flight first. So I'm eager to go back. I was all revved up and ready to go. But if you go to the Holy Land, you will likely be taken to Caesarea Philippi, or the ancient site of Caesarea Philippi, where there is a temple. There are a number of temples here. And you can see there's a temple there. There's this massive cave off to the side. And people will read what Jesus says to Peter in Matthew 16 against the backdrop of this. See, there's this massive rock. What's the word I'm looking for here? It's like a rock face, you know, a side of a hill here. And people will say, when Jesus tells Peter he's going to build the church on a rock, it's about this, because, you know, this is Caesarea Philippi. That's where Jesus was. He was at Caesarea Philippi, and they're standing there in front of this pagan temple, and Jesus is speaking here of this. So I do have an article on this online. If anybody wants to go more into this in more depth, you can just Google, my name and Caesarea Philippi or something like that. It's on my blog, The Sacred Page, which I haven't posted on in quite a while. But Elaine Phillips is a representative writer in this regard. She's talking about what happens in Caesarea Philippi. And she says, in the heart of this thriving city, Caesarea Philippi, encompassed by stone images to Syrian and Greek gods and an imposing temple devoted to the imperial cult, Jesus asked his disciples to identify him. So in her description, right, they're in the middle of Caesarea Philippi. They're in the middle of this bustling city. That's not reading the Gospels careful, right? So let's take a look at this. Matthew 16, 13. When Jesus came into the district, he's not in the city. He's in the district of Caesarea Philippi. He asked the disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? How about the Gospel of Mark? Jesus went out with his disciples toward the villages of Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? He's not in the middle of the city here. He's not standing in front of this pagan temple. They're on their way to Caesarea Philippi. They're within the district of Caesarea Philippi. In the Gospel of Luke, we read, now while he was praying alone, he's not in the middle of the city. He's off by himself, right? He would often go up to a mountain to pray, go off by himself. Jesus is in a remote area when the disciples come to him, and Jesus asks them, who do the people say that I am? Who do the crowd say that I am? Right? Now, if we go on and read the scene in Matthew, of course, you know what happens. Simon Peter says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says to him, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who's in heaven, I say to you, you are Peter, Petros in Greek, and upon this rock, Petra, I will build my church. People have made a big deal out of this, that Jesus uses a different word for rock when he's talking about what he will build on than the word that's used for Peter's name, Petros. And they say, oh, well, that's clear that Peter is not the rock. That's nonsense. The reason there's a distinction there is because Petra is the word that is used for a foundation stone, something you build on. And it's a feminine term. Petra is feminine. Jesus can't call Peter Petrina. So he gives him the masculine name there, right? And then he goes on to say, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Okay, well, people will go back and they'll look at the site, and they'll see that cave and they'll say, yeah, and that was the gates of hell. There's no evidence that this was known as the gates of hell. This is pure fiction. This is stuff that people say to sound smart or to sound like they know what they're talking about when they take you to Caesarea Philippi. By the way, just one thing about this passage, because we were talking about Matthew 23 before. There are some amazing parallels between Matthew 16 and Matthew 23. So I said that it's an overlooked passage, right? That Jesus says, you have to do whatever the scribes and Pharisees tell you because they sit on Moses' seat. So that raises a question. Do you listen to everything the Pharisees say? Do you follow rabbinic writings? Jesus says, you have to do whatever they tell you. So I guess everybody should go out and get a copy of the Mishnah and practice everything the scribes and Pharisees said, right? I mean, I want people to feel the force of that, because I don't think we often hear what Jesus says. We just jump to him criticizing Pharisees who are hypocritical. How do we deal with that? Well, I think Matthew 16 helps us read Matthew 23, right? Or Matthew 23 needs to be read in light of Matthew 16. What does Jesus say to Peter in Matthew 16? Whatever you bind, deo, in Greek, on earth, will be bound, the Dedemonon, in heaven. And then we have the same, and that could be translated, will be bound or will have been bound in heaven. But the interesting thing is in Matthew 23, it's the Pharisees that have the authority to bind. They bind heavy burdens. So the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat, and that gives them the authority to bind and loose. And Jesus gives that authority to Peter. Likewise, Jesus says to Peter, I give you the keys, kleidos is the Greek word there, of the kingdom of heaven. And in Matthew 23, Jesus says to the scribes and Pharisees, you key shut the kingdom of heaven against people. The English translations usually say that, you know, you shut out people out of the kingdom of heaven or something like that. But the Greek word there, you key, it's kliete. It's to lock something with a key, right? So the scribes and Pharisees have binding authority. They have the keys. And then Jesus gives that to Peter. So I think it's important to see here that what Jesus says about the scribes and Pharisees, he's saying about Peter. Peter's going to have that authority. So if you want to fulfill Jesus' teaching in Matthew 23, I think the Matthean community would understand you've got to listen to Peter, right? And I just add one more thing, and that is when we look at that passage, we could say a lot about Matthew 16. But when we look at that passage, we go on to see Peter rebuke Jesus. You're not going to suffer. You're not going to die. You know. And then we go on to see that Peter betrays Jesus. And so in Matthew 23, Jesus condemns the scribes and Pharisees for not practicing what they preach. And Peter does that too. And that's the Catholic understanding of the papacy too, right? That the popes have the authority to bind and loose. That doesn't necessarily mean that they're all saints. And we know from history, many terrible examples of popes that have not been saints. But the key thing is, no pun intended, is that in Matthew 16, Jesus is talking about building the church on the rock as the son of David. And that reminds us, of course, of the Davidic traditions. The son of David built the temple on the rock. Jesus is not comparing the church to a pagan temple, right? That's what people say when they go to Banias, and they miss the Jewish backdrop. They missed the Davidic connections. In the Old Testament, God told David he would have a son and his son would build a temple to his name. Jesus is the son of God. Davidic king is the son of God. It says in 2 Samuel 7, 1 Chronicles 17, you know, God will be, and God says, I will be his father, the son of David, his father, and he shall be my son, right? So he will be a son to me, right? So Jesus is the son of God. He's Davidic king. He's Davidic Messiah. As the first person Matthew emphasizes, Jesus, the book of Jesus Christ, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, son of David, the son of Abraham, he's the Christ, the son of David, and he's going to build something. And what he's going to build is the true temple, right? He's going to build the church. And that doesn't mean that the temple is not the true temple or not an authentic place where God dwells. Mm. We can talk about that later, but right. Anyway, all right.
All right, Dr. Barber.
Enough on that.
I always love when I get to talk about or hear someone talk about Matthew 16. So
yeah. Great.
you have a great paper about Jesus as Davidic temple builder in that passage.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, and if people are interested in that too, I just mentioned, I do have, I treat that also in an extended way in this book, The Historical Jesus and the Temple. And that's available through Cambridge University Press. And right now it is December 2nd. And for the next 15 days, you can get that at 30% off.
All right. I need to upload this quickly then so people get the deal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, you can get it there. But anyway, that is, it's something I'm really interested in is how does Jesus use temple imagery for the church, right? But then that doesn't mean that Jesus doesn't respect the temple or think God doesn't dwell in the temple. Temple's not holy. And I think sometimes when people go to Banias and they're like, he's this pagan temple, they overlook how offensive that would have been for Jewish ears, right? The church is like a pagan temple. No, the church is going to be like the temple of God, where God dwells in Jerusalem. So anyway.
All right. Claim number five. This is an interesting one. The temple was the only means of atonement such that when John the Baptist was, I guess, baptizing, he was implicitly rejecting the temple.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot here, but I mean, do you want me to read the rest of it, or we could maybe?
No, that's
just
good. Let's
just
talk about that. Let's talk about that. Yeah, let's talk about that. That's a really significant issue. So one of my concerns is, as a Catholic scholar, emphasizing the Jewishness of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And Catholics don't often know this, but in church history, Catholics and Jews are often linked together. So when Augustine is writing against the Montanists of his day, the Montanists all accuse the Catholics of being Jewish. Why? Because the Catholics believe in priesthood and sacrifice and these things and other things, right? The scriptures. So this often happens that in discourse, anti-Catholicism and anti-Semitism go together. So a lot of people will want to downplay the temple and priesthood and ritual worship, right? In the Gospels. And so you'll see people turn, for example, to the story of John the Baptist's baptism. Mark 1:4. John was baptizing in the desert and preaching a baptism of repentance. John was baptizing in the desert and preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people will say, see, John was offering people forgiveness of sins. Up until this time, you had to go to the temple. I'll give you an example of this. This is Robert Webb. He has a book, John the Baptizer and Prophet, a socio-historical study. And he writes this: John's baptism provided an alternative to the temple sacrificial system as a means of forgiveness. And so you'll get this, Webb is a Protestant, you'll get this in a lot of Protestant writings, right? The idea that, well, Jesus is trying to get us away from the temple. John the Baptist is critical of the temple. And it plays into this stereotype, right? That ritual is bad, right? But if you actually look in the Bible, you'll see that there are lots of times where people are forgiven apart from anything going on in the temple. Think about David and his sin of adultery against Bathsheba, right? David is confronted by Nathan the prophet. He tells him that famous story of the man who has the little lamb, you know. And then David says, you know, whoever this man is, he shall die. And then Nathan turns around and says, you're the man. You did this, right? And David then repents. He says, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to him, now the Lord has put away your sin. You shall not die. He doesn't go on and say, but only if you offer a sacrifice in the temple. Doesn't say that. The Lord forgives you once you have offered a sin sacrifice, right? Or sacrifice for sin, purification, a chatat, right? That's not what he says, right? So you could be forgiven apart from temple worship, even in the Old Testament. And you see this even more clearly in the book of Sirach, Sirach 3. Whoever honors his father atones for sins. Almsgiving can be a form of atonement. Sirach 3 goes on to say, water extinguishes a blazing fire, so almsgiving atones for sin. Sirach 3:30. Sirach 20:28. Whoever pleases great men will atone for injustice. So you'll often have people go around and they'll say things like, well, when the temple was destroyed, this created a massive crisis in Judaism. Because now the whole Old Testament system doesn't work because you have to offer sacrifices to atone for sin. But Jewish scholars will come back and say, well, no, already in Sirach, there were ways of atoning for sin apart from the temple. And more scholars are recognizing that the destruction of the temple in AD 70 wasn't the kind of catastrophic breakdown for Judaism that people have made it out to be, right? So it's important to recognize that John the Baptist is not implicitly saying, oh yeah, temple's no good. We don't need ritual anymore, right? He's not saying that. There always were other ways to find forgiveness of sins apart from the temple cult. We can say a lot more about that, but suffice it to say, what I want to underscore here is John the Baptist and Jesus, they're not implicitly rejecting the importance of the temple by announcing repentance and forgiveness of sins.